had a knee operation, did my knee ACL, and all of a sudden my life just went from downhill very quickly. It started going from maybe binge drinking once a month, once every 3 weeks, to once every 2 weeks, to pretty much just like three times a week, binge drinking, using drugs as much as I can. Probably when I was 17, did ice bath a handful of times, and then from there my behaviour just got worse and worse. I got to a stage where I wasn't even playing football anymore. I dropped out of school altogether, and I was just getting into more crime, more fights, whether it was at the pub, you know, and then it just got worse and worse and worse. You know, I ended up, I'll tell you one story that happened when I was about, when I was 18, just turned 18. I had gone home for probably 2 weeks, and I was just living in a mate's house, came back, and my dad had all my stuff at the front, and from there, you know, he said, I can't have you in the house anymore. Using ice, you know, I can't have you around his daughter, my sister. It's too dangerous for the family and ourselves, so we don't want you here anymore, type thing. I just said, piss off, took my bags, went upstairs, he called the police. There was two police cars there within a matter of 10 minutes. They came into the house and sort of started off very slowly, and within half an hour, we're basically getting into an altercation on my living room, my lounge room floor. Here's my dad, he's not a violent guy or anything like that. He's never done a thing wrong with his life, and he's looking there just crying to see, you know, me have this fight with the police basically down in the room. So there's like a rock bottom moment for me, and I remember I woke up about six hours later thinking I was in a police cell or something like that, but I was actually down the road at a psych ward. So that's something I never would have thought, you know, I would have ended up like that. You know, I was the captain of the team. I was going to be like year 12 school captain possibly. You know, I had got the world at my feet, but because of bad decisions, drugs, hanging around the wrong crowd, I completely fucked my life up, and I'm here to tell you about some of it now. So it's something that I talked about when I found out these two guys from my football club took their own life. It motivated me to share my story, but I also talked in schools about what bad decisions can end you through to your life. So from there, I ended up getting incarcerated for probably 10 weeks down the road at the Melbourne Remand Centre. And from there, I was given a 6-month sentence at a rehab, and pretty much I was clean for most of that time. Then I got out and relapsed straight away, started hanging around the wrong crowd again, old mates, and then pretty much just got straight back on the ice. From there, my behaviour just spiraled out of control. I was involved in a road rage incident where basically I was with this other guy, and we were drugging on for about a week, and we were driving down the road, and these two tradies sort of like pulled in front of us, and we gave them the finger or something like that. They've given us the finger. We've sort of gone after them. They've pulled over down the side street to say, like, let's get fired or something like that. And that's when me and my mate have like charged them to fight. I've actually pulled out a knife and stabbed them both 3 times. I remember when I did it, I looked at him on the ground. I thought, fuck, I might have killed him or something like that. You know, and I'll end up going back, getting back on drugs, whatever it might be, and just continue on thinking life as normal. This behaviour went on, all this sort of crazy shit, for a few more months, and I was brought in by the police, taken into custody, and from there, I remember I was given a bail for like 4 months, and I tried my best to get clean, but I was still having these lapses in and out, hanging out with old mates, going on all these benders, and my behaviour was just getting still, like, I was trying to do the right thing. But when I was 20 years old, I was finally taken in front of the judge, and on the Monday, he gave me a sentence indication of 5 years in the adult prison system. And I just remember seeing my mum, my dad, my sister, my grandma just crying and stuff in the court, and thinking that, you know, I'm just going to be stuck in the system forever. But I came back on the Wednesday, and that's when it was actually my 21st birthday, and the judge said, I want to send you, instead of sending you to adult prison, I want to give you some kind of opportunity, so I'm sending you to Marshall instead of 3 years. He was serving prison sentence from 18 to 23 years old. So from there, I pretty much got there and served 12 months of behaviour. When I got there straight away, I wanted to do everything to better my own life, but not only myself, my family. You know, I felt tremendous remorse and guilt for what I did to my victims, my family, myself. So I did my VCA in there. I got clean. Everyone was using drugs there, and I just did my best to stay away from it. I still have contact with one person who's staying in our whole unit, who's doing really well now. The rest of them are either in jail, on drugs, on ice, psychotic, committed suicide, died in car accidents, or killed for who knows what. So it's a shit life, and I just wanted to get myself out of that situation. So as I said, I did everything I could. I was very fortunate that when I left Master in Detention, I was given an opportunity at the Dingley Football Club. They got me a job, and fortunate they gave me like a job and a position to play for them and everything like that. So for 2014, things were going really well for me. I was working full time, things were going well. I was off the drugs, and it was about halfway through that year where I started to go out a little bit, binge drink like I used to. And all of a sudden, I just remember I've been thinking something. It was like a Sunday afternoon, I was just watching the footy or something like that, and I just started to like cry for like 10 minutes. And I remember getting out my phone and just like called the old blue, and then straight away when they started ringing or someone picked up, I just hanged up the phone. Because at that time, you know, I was embarrassed about what it was. I was ashamed. I thought, why am I crying now? You know, I've been through so much more worse stuff than this, and here I am just like crying for no reason on a Sunday afternoon when I'm in my own home watching the footy, like what's going on type thing. So I pushed it to the side because I didn't want to deal with myself. I didn't want to deal with the embarrassment and shame about it. So probably a month later, a similar thing happened where, you know, I just started to break down, and then it all sort of started to fall apart for me, where once a month this would happen to, you know, once every 3 weeks, once every 2 weeks, and then just generally from there, I was just feeling that something was a bit different. I was noticeably a bit more anxious in social situations, and I didn't go to footy or work or whatever it was, or hang around mates as much as I would have liked to, and I was just getting anxious in social situations. I started having these like breakdowns for no apparent reason. And I just remember I went to Beyond the Valley Festival 2015, 2016, 2017, 2015. And I remember I was just around the campfire with all my mates going to school and everything, and everyone was like, you know, Bolger's doing really well, he's got his life back together. But, you know, inside I was really struggling. I think the next, that day I got on a bunch of drugs. The next day I just went sitting around the campfire and I started to get a panic attack, and I just, you know, just had to get out of there. And I went to my tent and I just pretty much put my head in my pillow, just pulled my eyes out the whole night. I could hear the fireworks, I could hear everything. You know, I didn't know, I could hear everyone laughing, having time, but here I was just trapped in this cycle of like my own mental health issues. I didn't know what was happening. I just kept having these moments where I wouldn't sleep that well for 2-3 days, and then other times where I would have no energy at all, and sometimes this up and down roller coaster. So I remember thinking that when footy would come across, you know, things would just disappear. So I remember the first practice game, I pulled over in my car on the way to the game, and I just broke down. I thought, fuck, like, how am I gonna play? Like, I just want to play, but it's going to be so difficult. So for the most part of that year, you know, I'll just put my hat, my sunglasses on, and just do everything I could just to sort of basically pretend that so people would think I'm doing okay. You know, I remember the first game that year, we played down at Sandringham Oval. I grew up around the corner from that oval. We used to play juniors there and stuff. And about halfway through the third quarter, you know, this team that we used to play, we played them in the grand final the year before, we got beaten. They used to constantly drill me, like, you know, bulge, junkie, go back to jail, all this sort of stuff. And for some reason, halfway through that third quarter, I just felt this, you know, immense panic and everything that's been going on. And I could actually feel myself that, you know, like, physically about to break down. I was like, fuck, you know, like, I can't let anyone see what's going on here, because, you know, as men, we're taught to be tough and suppress our emotions, never show weakness and all that sort of stuff. And I remember I just managed to push through it. I got to the end of the game. I remember I wanted to get my bag and get out of there as quickly as I could, so I couldn't find my bag or something like that. So I went to the floor, locked myself in the thing, and just waited to leave my leg. I was just completely wrecked. Everyone was knocking on the door saying, Bulge, what are you doing? You're not coming out for a drink or something. And I said, I'm fucking sick or something. And I waited to leave my left. And I remember that night, you know, I was just like so down and drained out. I remember I actually came out and I was locked in this place, like a room like this, for hours. It was bizarre. I ended up trying to walk through the crawl space and I found some key, got out of there. And, you know, as I was walking off the football oval, I got a lift to the game. I remember going past this overpass bridge thing to walk home, and it was the first time I really contemplated on taking my own life. You know, I just looked over the bridge, the train and stuff, and I thought, you know, I'm going to do this, but I couldn't do it. I just kept seeing my mum and what she would have to go through. So this was sort of throughout the whole year, where like I was having these sort of ups and downs, but they were all sort of just a complete roller coaster of me going to work, having to go 5 minutes down there to the course or whatever it might be. So from there, at the end of the year, we won the grand final, and that was awesome and everything like that. But this is where my summer started to slide into control, where I started to get these ups, where I'd be, you know, very anxious, have a lot of energy, quite talking into other stages where I'd be down and very depressed. I remember I actually got pinged in at a nightclub in December, and I had these concussion symptoms that were just lingering. I was constantly getting headaches from all the bloody fights and stuff I used to get into when I was younger, and I was just in a bad headspace at the time. You know, I was drinking too much, I was using Valium, painkillers, a lot of prescription medication just to calm my nerves and whatever was going on. And I just remember my mental health got worse and worse and worse, to a point where I remember it was one Saturday, and my dad went for a clean out for the day or something like that. And I just remember my two best mates at the time were playing cricket, and I messaged them to say sort of like, you know, thanks for your help, thanks for your support, you know, like have a good life. I think it was like a goodbye note or something. And I just remember grabbing 10 pills, another 10 pills, and within, you know, a minute I would have had 50 pills, thinking that, you know, that I was 100% content on that. This was the time I was going to take my own life, you know. There was times where I had thought about it and maybe planned it, but, you know, I thought about it, and then I like sort of stopped at the last second, but this time I actually went through with it. My mate kept calling me, I was in and out of consciousness, and I've answered the 10th phone call or something, and he said, where are you? Can you straight away something was going on? And I said, I was too late, you know. He said, are you with your dad? And I said, yes, and he drove there, he was there within 5 minutes, and he kicked down the back door, got in there, and I was unconscious, and I was vomiting, and he pulled me over to my side, so essentially saved my life, which, you know, if it was there a few minutes later, I wouldn't be here in front of you telling you my story. So that's how close it was for me, but also that was my rock bottom moment. But I had to, you know, my coach stepped in and played an important role. I seeked out for help. You know, I was just didn't know how to talk about my issues. I just kept everything a secret. You know, I was already went through a lot of drug issues when I was younger, to being incarcerated, as I said, to these mental health issues. And I just, when I was going through these mental health issues, I didn't want to let anyone down, because I thought I was doing a bad thing by, you know, going through this or spiraling out of control. I didn't want to let my friends, my family down by telling them about this. I thought that I was a burden. So from there, that's when my coach picked me up and took me to a psychologist for the first time I've seen in my life, and I had a tremendous benefit from him. I was seeing him on a weekly basis, and I checked myself into a private mental health clinic where I've seen treatment for 3 weeks. From there, I was diagnosed having bipolar 2 depression and put on medication for that. So from there, I just got a diploma in counselling, and I got a job in an Aboriginal youth centre in the country, because I'm Aboriginal myself and very passionate about helping our people. And from there, that's when my life's just gone like this. And it was one day, as I said, two players from the club, two people around the community committed suicide, and I just ran up the local football league, and I said, you know, I used to play in the comp 2 years ago, they knew who I was, and I said, I want you to write something in the local football, like paper or whatever it was, talking about my story. You know, I want you to be brutally honest about my mental health issues, or beyond blue round or something. So, because I wanted people to read it, and, you know, instead of seeing someone's, you know, that's like all this footy goss, I wanted people to read it and say, hey, shit, if it can happen to Bulge, it can happen to anyone. So that Saturday, that Thursday, I got all of my mates in the room that I used to play for, and all the guys around the club, everyone in this small little room, and I just talked about mental health, talked about my own story, talked about, you know, my demons when I was going through in these rooms, you know, 2 years ago, for those 2 years, and, you know, it was just awesome. It was a really good conversation with everyone, talking about, you know, the last times they saw that person, you know, what they could have done, what they could have said, and how we all need it, you know, as blokes, particularly as blokes, I know there is women in the room and stuff, but I'm saying, like, as particularly as blokes, you know, we tend to leave out the side of how we're feeling, how emotions going, you know, we tend to push it aside. But I guess one of the reasons I'm here today is, you know, just be wary of, you know, your mates, their life, your players, other teammates, whatever it might be. You don't know what's going on in their life. They could have had a breakdown, relationship breakdown, financial issues, job prospects, education, whatever it might be. Just be wary of, you know, whether someone is going through mental health issues. It was only 3 days ago, someone I knew from the community actually took his own life as well. And I actually I mentioned to my mate who knows him quite well, I took him out for coffee and I mentioned I wanted to tell him in person what happened. And I just remember telling him, and he straight away said, you know, like the last few days I've been feeling like shit. I've been wanting to call John Blue, but I just don't know what to say. I don't know if that was related because he was going through something to do with his partner at the time. You know, so it just goes to show how easy it is for guys, you know, to just not talk about their issues because they don't want to be unmanly and stuff like that. But I'm telling you, it's bullshit. It takes more strength for someone to talk about their issues, talk about what's going on with their life, and seek treatment, seek help, and you can get better because essentially that's what's killing Australian males all over this country. So it's motivated me to do what I do now. I do social work, and I also do, I've done hundreds of these talks to like football clubs, cricket clubs, football clubs, schools, whatever it might be. And I'm living proof that things can get better no matter how bad your situation is. I'm very happy at the moment. I've got a very good job, and in a month that's going to come in late notice. I'm away. I'm travelling around for 12 months around Africa and India and stuff like that to get footage to take into these schools so I can talk more about mental health resilience and everything like that. So I appreciate listening to my story today, but if anyone is going through any struggles or anything like that, I encourage you to seek help because things can get better. You know, I've been rock bottom many times, but you know, at the moment things are going really well in my life, and they have been going for probably like 18 months, 2 years now. You know, I talk about my issues with my friends and family, and I've got my life back. But thanks for listening. I'll talk to everyone, so cheers.